In 2007, the thing that made the new iPhone operating system great was the MultiTouch interface. This was so groundbreaking that it's now hard to recall what it felt like before we used glass touchscreens. This is an iPod Touch, released the same year as the first iPhone. It also runs iPhoneOS, which in later years came to be called iOS 1. The first iPod and iPhone have a different app selection. The iPhone apps that were missing from the iPod included phone and SMS, of course, but also maps, weather, camera, because no camera on the iPod, mail, stocks, and funnily enough, iPod. Instead, the iPod had some different apps called Music, Videos, and the iTunes app. iPhone, of course, has these functions, but they're all in the iPod app. iPod weirdly also has a Contacts app. There is no way to add apps to the first iPod or iPhone because the App Store didn't exist at the time. You simply had these apps and nothing else. As great as this new multi-touch operating system was, using it sometimes felt like a prison. Today with the App Store, when we can't run the apps that Apple doesn't like, it's called a walled garden approach, which is another way of saying a walled courtyard, which is a good description of a prison. Imagine buying a new house, but the builder has put restrictions on what you can and cannot do in your house. They also added a hidden room that controls the security of your house. All your security cameras' feeds go into this room. But the builder has told you that for your security, you're not allowed to access that room. It's locked for your own protection. How safe do you feel now? This is how our modern devices work. Jailbreaking is the process of smashing down that door. On Android, this is called rooting, and I do root my Android as well. There's got to be a better way to say that. Today, I'm going to jailbreak my iPod just like I did in 2007. Here is the iOS 1 or first iPhone OS lock screen. When we slide to unlock, we reveal the 11 apps on this iPod. Now, I have already downgraded this from the last compatible iOS version, which was 3.1.3, and this was before Apple locked out iOS downgrading. Though even without that limitation, this process was still quite an ordeal. And this is because not all cables work. Even some genuine Apple cables can struggle to do a restore with iTunes. They may be able to charge and sync with iTunes, but restoring firmware and jailbreaking may not work with all cables. I think this is because of the USB ports and all the different USB controllers in different computers simply not being Apple compatible. Oh, and you also need Windows XP. I did try a few different computers, and in the end, I dropped my XP SSD back into my Veo UX. This was the only one I could get working with Apple USB. I chose to downgrade to iOS 1.1.5. This was the last version of iOS 1, and it was available for iPod only. Apple had released this version alongside iOS 2, which on iPod was a paid upgrade. It's time to jailbreak. To jailbreak, I'm going to use iLiberty Plus. This is one of the first complete jailbreaks in that it's easy to use and has many additional options, such as activating and unlocking. I'm checking the Adcydia box. It's just a matter of starting the process and allowing the software to do its thing. The jailbreaking process involves exploiting a flaw in Apple's security and using that to our advantage. In this case, installing software that Apple doesn't want us to install. Once completed, we now have Cydia. Cydia is a great way to install software outside of Apple's control. Unfortunately, Cydia is no longer supported on iOS 1, and it's basically useless. Instead, it's recommended to install the original alternative called Installer, which I'm doing here using the Add Payload function in iLiberty Plus. However, try as I might, and I couldn't get Installer to work, even after adding the current online repositories of third-party apps. This can be a problem when relying on online services with legacy devices, even in the jailbreak realm. I always tend to prefer offline methods. So instead, I've downloaded some app packages. There are some software called iBricker, which can install software locally. This is all before the more recent DEB format was available on iOS, so the apps must be in PXL format to work. Fortunately, I was able to get this method working, and I now have my first generation iPod Touch with a jailbreak and a sampling of some third-party apps. I have the original Labyrinth game, which is actually really well done. And I've got a terminal program installed to give me low-level access to the operating system's commands. Not to mention this cool little NES emulator. Thanks to the dedication of the jailbreak community, there continues to be tools available to this day that can jailbreak every main version of iOS. Jailbreaking's not for everyone, and it can be quite complicated. Done improperly, and you can risk making your device less safe. However, an experienced jailbreaker can make it even more secure. Thanks to the hard work of many skilled people over the years, I've been able to jailbreak every iOS device I've ever owned. I jailbreak because I sometimes need to do things outside of Apple's limited ideas of how they think things should work. I also really enjoy that feeling of freedom that comes with jailbreaking and making something uniquely your own. I want to do some more jailbreaking one day, but first, I have some more tech from the 1990s that I'm keen to explore. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.